So today we'll begin with the general machine structure, and we'll continue after the first part. That is, we'll go through the memory, the register, the data and instruction formats for a IBM 360 machine, right? So the basic storage unit of IBM 360 machine is a byte, and as we already know that 1 byte is equal to 8 bits of information. Now it is not necessary, or it is not essential, that every set of information I use has to be limited within 8 bits, right? So to operate on contiguous bits, that is which are larger than 8 bits, that is larger than 1 byte, some basic units are defined, which are known as byte, half word, word, double word, etc., right? So each of these basic units has their own size. So 1 byte is obviously 8 bits in length. A half word is equal to 2 bytes, and that is a length of 16 bits. A word is equal to 4 bytes, it has a length of 32 bits, and a double word is twice that of a word, so it has a size of 8 bytes and it is a 64 bit length, right? So size of a IBM 360 memory is 2 to the power 24 bytes. This table we need to remember. Now there are 16 general purpose registers. Each register has a capacity of 32 bit. There are 4 floating point registers of 64 bits each, and there is one program status word or PSW which stores the value of a location counter, protection information or interrupt status. So whichever I need, I can store it in the 64 bit program status word. So there are 3 parts or 3 divisions in which I can divide the types of registers. Now the general purpose registers, as we already noted, that there are 16 of them, each of 32 bit size. So these 16 registers are named from R0 to R15. These registers are generally used for arithmetic and logical operations such as scratch pads, as we have already studied in the previous lecture. They are used for intermediate value storage in operations like addition, subtraction, comparison, etc. Now these registers R0 to R15 can also be used as base registers in address formation. This is one thing that we'll learn here. So let's go to the next slide. As a base register, the general purpose registers can be used very effectively. So let's consider an instruction for IBM 360. The instruction is A1,901 within brackets 2,15. So this instruction has a specific interpretation for the IBM 360 PC. The A is a opcode which can be interpreted as an add instruction. This 1 indicates a register value. So basically a particular value is supposed to be added to the content of register 1. Now where is the value stored? The value is stored in some memory address. This address is indicated by 901 2,15. Now how do we get the actual address location? We get the address location by adding 901 with the content of register 2 and the content of register 15. This 901 value is called the offset value, whereas register 2 is known as the index value and register 15 is the base, right? So how do we get the final memory location where the value is stored? We get the final memory location by adding the value 901 with the content of register 2 and the content of register 15. That will give me a final memory location of the value. This value we need to add with whatever content we already have in register 1. That is how we can interpret this instruction, right? Moving forward, there are certain advantages of using base registers. That is, there is certain advantage of using the registers to store the base value. Let's go through the advantages. First one is relocation. So using a base register, the main advantage is that we can shift a program or a series of instructions from one location in the memory to a separate location by simply changing the base address, right? The second advantage, it promotes efficient addressing so that the user does not need to completely remember every memory location, right? We can easily work with a simple base and index value and use a constant offset. Without base registers, 24 bits would be required for every address. That is, if a user wanted to maintain the address as a whole, he would require 24 bits to keep that in a memory, right? So this first figure, this first diagram to the left, it shows the scenario where there is a address stored as a whole, and the diagram to the right shows the case where address is broken down into index, base and offset. So as we can easily find that in the diagram on the left there are total bit requirement of 40, whereas in the diagram to the right there is a total bit requirement of 32 bits. So using base addressing, we can always ensure that there is a saving of 8 bits per address reference, fine. So these are the advantages of using registers as base registers. There are certain disadvantages too. So there is an overhead in address formation during execution. So when we are executing a program, the machine needs to actually determine the address location by going through the base, index and the offset. So that is a extra overhead. Again, the data has to be within a range of 0 to 4095 locations away from the address to which base is pointing. That is because, as we already see, as we have already seen, the base register, it consists of an offset of 12 bits, right? So 12 bits can hold a value that is of the size 2 to the power 12, which means there are 4096 addresses possible for the offset. Now base can only shift the offset by a certain value, but this offset value has to be limited between 4096 addresses, right? So if we have a substantially large program which needs which requires address locations beyond 4096, then this type of addressing mode is completely disadvantageous, right? The next topic is the data formats. Now we will not go into details of each of these data formats, we'll just need to know their names. So there is a short term fixed point number, a long form fixed point number, packed decimals, unpacked decimals, short form floating point, long form floating point, and logical or character data, right? The instructions. Now every instruction includes two parts. It has two components. The first one, initial one, is an opcode. The opcode or the operation code, it specifies the operation that is to be performed. The second part of instruction, it includes zero or more operands. Now, so as we have already seen, every operator works on an operand, right? So here the opcode works with certain operands. Now these operands may be specifying registers, may be specifying memory locations or some literal data. Now again, these operands may be using different addressing modes which determine their meaning, or they may be in fixed fields, as we'll see in the next slides. So basically an instruction consists of two parts, one opcode and zero or more operands, right? Moving forward, there are different types of instructions. We could have arithmetic instructions, we could have some special interrupt instructions, and we could have some control instructions. Types of register operands will tell us that there are three types. The first one is the register operand itself, which refers to data stored in one of the 16 general registers, and it is addressed by a 4-bit field in instruction. So a register operand refers to data stored in one of the 16 general registers. Then there comes the storage operand. The storage operands refer to data which are stored in the core memory, not in the registers, right? And the length of operand depends on the data type, fine. The third one is the immediate operand, where a single byte of data is stored as part of the instruction itself. So there are three types of operands, register operands. The first one is the register to register operand, where the data is stored in one of the 16 registers. Second one is the storage operand, where the data is stored in the actual core memory, and the length of the operand will depend on the data type. And the third one is the immediate operand, where there is a single byte of data which is stored in the instruction itself, fine. Different instruction formats that we are going to go through: RR, RX, RS, SI and SS. So the RR format is the register to register operation, right? So as we can see on the diagram, both the operands, there is R1 and there is R2, both of these are registers, and length of the instruction is 2 bytes, right? So as we can see in this given example, this operation is the add operation, and what do we need to add? We need to add the contents of register R1 with the contents of register R2. So this is a register to register type instruction, right? It uses the register operands. Moving on, we have the RX format. Now the RX format is the most common format that we will be using all throughout our following lectures, right? So we need to critically go through the RX format and make sure we understand it. Let me repeat, as we are going through a video lecture, at any point if you feel you are having some trouble understanding things, you can always pause it, and you can always rewind and go through it again, right? Okay, moving forward, the RX format, the diagram for the RX format is given on the right, and we will come to it in a moment. Now the RX format uses register and indexed storage operation. So this is a sort of a storage operand, right? We had studied there are three types of register operands. The second one was storage operand. So the RX format uses storage operand as well as register operations. Length of the instruction is 4 bytes in all. And the indexed storage refers to data stored in the core memory. Fine. So in the RX format, we work with two things. One, there is a register, and the second one is the data stored in core memory. Now, how do we retrieve the data in core memory? Right. So let's look at the diagram now. We can see it's written OP. OP is for opcode. R1 is the name of the register itself. Then there is X2, B2, and D2. Now, as we have already seen in the previous example for a general purpose register as base address, where we saw the instruction for addition, right? We will again go through the same example. The RX instruction given here is ADD3,16,0,5, right? So what does this indicate? This indicates that the value stored in core memory location, that value of the core memory location will be determined by X2, B2 and D2. So there is a particular value which is stored in the memory location. The memory location is specified by X2, B2 and D2. We will take that value from the memory location and we will add that value to the content of register, right? Register 1. That is what this instruction tells us, fine. So we will add the content stored in memory location 16, 0,5, and we will add that content to the value of register 3. So for that, a generalized formula for determining the location can be given as address equal to value of offset or displacement, which is specified by D2. Please note that since the machine language is completely in zeros and ones, the actual representation is what is written within these blocks. But the representation that we understand is in the decimal form, which is written beneath the blocks, right? So for D2, we have the binary representation. Its decimal part is 16, fine. So address equal to value of offset or displacement, which is given by D2. So value of offset is right now 16. Plus contents of the base register, that is C of B2. Now C of B2, content of base register B2. Content of base register B2, that means content of register 5, because 0101 means 5 in decimal, right? Then there's the content of the index register C, X2. So content of the index register C of X2. Now X2 contains a series of 4 zeros, so it contains a value of 0. So if we want to actually calculate the location, we will find that address of the storage operand equal to content of B2 plus content of X2 plus D2. Content of B2 means content of register 5. X2 has a 0, so it's 0. And then there's the offset value, which is 16. Now let's assume that general register 5 contains a value 1000, right? So in this case, we will have C of 5 as 1000. Plus, since X2 is 0, we have a 0, and then for the offset, we have 16. So the actual address of the storage operand is 1016, fine. So using this formula or using this general structure, we can easily determine what the memory location is for a particular value. So what will this instruction do? This instruction will take the value from memory location 1016, and this instruction will store that value. Where will it store the value? It will store the value in register 3 after adding it to the contents of register 3, right? So the instruction is add 3 16 0,5. So the content from this memory location will be added to content of register 3 and stored in register 3 itself. This is what the RX format represents, right? So for all official purposes in the course of this syllabus, we will always, or most of the times, we'll go through the RX format only, right? So make sure you understand this format. The next one is the SS format. The SS format uses two storage operands. So there was the RR format, which used only register operands. The RX format used a register operand and a storage operand. And then comes the SS format, which involves two storage operands. It does not involve a register operand at all, right? So in this case, there is an opcode, then there's two addresses, B1 D1, B2 D2, right? So address of operand 1, that is the address where value first value is kept can be retrieved as content of B1 plus D1, content of B1 plus offset, that is content of register 5 plus offset. Assuming register 5 contains a value 1000, we have the address as 1032. Similarly, operand 2 can be calculated as, the address of operand 2 can be calculated as content of register B2 plus D2, that means content of register 5, content of the register with value 5, and the displacement or the offset is 300, so the address is 1300, right? Now, other than these two things, there is another part to the SS format where we have the name L, and we can see that L has 8 bits of information. These 8 bits of information actually specify the length of the data that is to be copied. I repeat, the L specifies the length of the data that is to be copied. In our case, L has a value 01001111. This, when translated to decimal, denotes 79, right? Now, L always denotes the length of the data to be copied, and the value of L is always 1 less than the total length. The value denoted by L is 1 less than the total length. So, in this case, the total length is 79 plus 1, that is 80. So, what are we supposed to do? What does this instruction make us do? This instruction tells us that we are supposed to copy 80 values. We are supposed to copy a value whose length is 80 bits from location 1032 to location 1300. So, this instruction copies, or we can say it moves, the 80 bytes of data. The 80 bytes of data are stored where? They are stored at location 1032. Now, all the 80 bytes can't be stored at location 1032, right? So, they are stored starting at location 1032 up to location 1111. And these data values from these locations will be copied to the storage locations starting from 1300, as we have calculated. So, it will copy these values to the location starting at 1300 up to 1379. So, this is the work of the SS format, right? Moving on, we have the SI format. Now, as we had already noted, that the third type of register operand was the immediate storage operand, where the data was stored as a part of the instruction itself. So, as we can see in the diagram here, the data is stored in I2, and the data is 0100, then 0000. So, that can be represented as 64. Now, that is again the code for the character blank, right? So, the address is again calculated as C of B1 plus D1. So, D1 gives us the offset, and C of B1, that is content of B1, that is 5. Now, assuming register 5 contains a value, the value is 1000 as we had taken in the previous examples. So, we get the destination address as 1000 plus the value of offset, that is 1004, right? So, the given instruction causes the 1 byte, that is 0100000, 8 bits, or this 1 byte to be stored in the memory location denoted by B1 and D1. The memory location is calculated as 1004. Right? This is how the SI format works. I repeat, for whatever purposes we will follow in this semester, we will always be, or most of the times, we will be using the RX format only. Right? Okay. So, we are done with the SI format. Let's go through some instruction mnemonics in assembly language. Now, again, these mnemonics are mentioned in the RX format itself. So, these are some common representative instructions which are used in the IBM 360 machine. L denotes a load instruction. ST denotes a store instruction. A will denote add. C will denote compare. D will denote divide. M is for multiply. S is for subtract. And CL is for compare logical. We will be using most of these instructions, if not all, and at any point of time, if there is some other instruction that we need to go through, we will learn it then and there, right? So, these are the topics that we have covered today. We have gone through the memory of a general machine structure of IBM 360. We have gone through the registers, register operands. We have gone through the data, their types, and we have also gone through the instruction formats. There are 4 of them that we have discussed, and the last one we have left out, right? That is not relevant for us, we have left that out. So, there are 4 instruction formats that we have gone through. Fine. So, see you next day. If there are any references you need, you can always go through the notes that I have already provided, and you can always refer to the book by John Donovan. Take care.